special music, we're going to turn to the reading of God's Word, the ninth reading from Paul's letter to the Colossians, and the first chapter, Colossians chapter 1. While we're finding that, I'd like to say on my behalf and my wife, what a great delight it's been to be with you here in Beaumont for these past few days, just as we're now at our most settled and comfortable and relaxed and feeling the most at home, and we've been here the whole time, it's time to go. And I guess it's always like that when you're on the road, and we feel that especially so here. We're sorry to have to leave you and leave you very early in the morning, but we have enjoyed and appreciated your fellowship and your encouragement during these days. And it's been a remarkable meeting for the people who've been absent and the people who've been present. Perhaps also explain that, and I'll need to explain it now. You will know as you look around now by night what a large number of people who are here, say, on Sunday morning have been absent throughout the entire week. There will be many church members who, for one reason or another, or one excuse or another, have not been here one single service through the week. Now, I don't blame them for that. I went across the road to hear myself preach, and I don't blame them for being absent one little bit, not from a personal point of view. But I'm more concerned to thank and appreciate those who've been present. And it seems to me that the nucleus that have been present has been remarkable for its loyalty to this particular meeting. It must be most of you who are present at almost all of the morning services, and just about everybody here tonight has been at every single one of the night services. I'm wondering when I can ever remember a church where the nucleus was so much the same. I'm saying the same old faces every night. I didn't really mean to say it like that, it just came out like that. The same faces every night. And it seems to me with a growing enthusiasm and interest in the preaching and the teaching of God's Word. And that's been a great encouragement to me. I want to thank you for that. And of course, for your practical expression of love, which is certainly all that I need and more than I deserve. And we'll go to the work of Christian ministries, which I'm involved with two other colleagues, both in Britain and overseas. We do quite a lot of work in third world countries, Eastern Europe, which we've been doing now for over 20 years, way back in the years of the Warsaw Pact invasion in the late 1960s. I was going to Czechoslovakia for the first time. And we have great interest in those countries, both in preaching, in taking in help for those who are in need, and in supplying Christian literature. It's interesting, maybe interesting for you to know that a book length that I have called Ultimate Questions, we've not had here this week because the reprint wasn't ready in time. That booklet, which now has 1.1 million copies in print in just 3 years, is being reprinted at the moment, another 250,000 copies being printed, including the first editions in Russian and Hungarian and Bulgarian. Nearly 90,000 copies in Bulgarian being printed and already demanded hungrily in that country that's undergone such a remarkable change just recently. And so you are encouraging that kind of work and ministry in the days to come, and we do appreciate it. I almost never get a chance of doing this. Let me say that next week, beginning next Sunday, I'm going to be back here, gone away back, right in this very area, in fact, taking a Bible conference in Saraleigh, Texas. Great metropolis of Saraleigh, of which Houston is a suburb, as you all know. And that's where I'm going to be next week, God willing. I believe at Pine Ridge Baptist Church. No idea where it is. It's just a post office box number, as far as I'm concerned. So I'll just look at the box numbers and then I'll find the right one. I'll be there. But that's starting next Sunday through Wednesday with the morning service, I think, at around 11 or 11:30, and then an evening service at 7 or 7:30, I'm not even sure of that, but we'll get there, hopefully. I'm going to be sharing those particular services with a very good friend of mine, Victor McManus, an evangelist from Northern Ireland, who's lived in Texas for about 20 years now, and Victor and I are going to be doing a double header each night. I'll do the morning or the noon Bible studies. Victor and I will the end of that particular plan. And you'd be very welcome to come to those services if there is no conflict of anything that's going on here, because I'd be in trouble if I currently believe responsibilities here at Woodland. But if you can come, you'd be most welcome, as would be delighted to see you. Of course, I also want to take the opportunity of thanking your pastor and his wife, Susan, for their very gracious hospitality during these days. They've opened their home and their hearts to us, as I knew they would, and we appreciate all that they've done for us and then to us during these days. And we encourage you to encourage them every way that you can as they continue their ministry. Colossians chapter 1 then, and verse 15. The whole of this section is on the supremacy of Christ. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For by him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things were created by him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. Once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior. Now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight, without blemish and free from accusation, if you continue in your faith established and firm, not moved from the hope held out in the gospel. This is the gospel that you heard and that has been proclaimed to every creature under heaven, and of which I, Paul, have become a servant. Now I rejoice in what was suffered for you, and I fill up in my flesh what is still lacking in regard to Christ's afflictions for the sake of his body, which is the church. I have become its servant by the commission God gave me to present to you the word of God in its fullness, the mystery that has been kept hidden for ages and generations, but is now disclosed to the saints. To them God has chosen to make known among the Gentiles the glorious riches of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. We proclaim him, admonishing and teaching everyone with all wisdom, so that we may present everyone perfect in Christ. To this end, I labor, struggling with all his energy, which so powerfully works in me. May God bless to each one of us the reading.
Thank you.
blessed Holy Spirit. Our great and gracious God and Father, we come to you now in the quietness of these lovely moments. And as we do, we ask that you will graciously do for us that which we cannot do for ourselves. Open your word to our hearts. Open our hearts to your word. Give to each one of us the grace of understanding and the greater grace of obedience. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. A number of years ago, I was doing some business in London, downtown London, that is, and at the end of the day, towards the end of the afternoon, that is, I was running to Victoria Station, one of our railroad termini, in order to get a train back home, about 10 or 12 miles outside of the city. I was a little bit late, was almost going to miss the train, so I was rushing along the forecourt onto the platform, and as I rushed onto the platform and jumped on the train, I heard rather garbled announcement, and you may have noticed now they're always garbled and difficult to understand. If you're going to become an announcer at a railroad station, you have to have a voice that nobody can understand. That's the qualification, I think. And this was a very mixed, garbled, difficult to understand message about this particular train was going to divide when it got outside of the city at one of the first or second stops, and only the front part of the train was going on to the place which I wanted to get off. Well, I couldn't quite take all of that in. I was more determined to get on board and shut the door before the train moved on. And with a great sigh of relief, I did get on board just seconds before the train moved away, slammed the door behind me, sat down with a great sigh of relief, and then began to work. How far up this train was it going to divide? I knew that the front portion was going on to East Croydon, which is where I wanted to be, and that the rear portion of the train was going to be disconnected at Clapham Junction and was going no further. Now, was I far enough up the train? Was the train going all the way to the place for which my ticket had been paid and for which I hoped I was securely seated? It would have been useless just getting on the train if the train wasn't going to go all the way to where I wanted to get. I dreaded anybody asking, is this part of the train safe to go all the way to East Croydon, because I really didn't know myself. Mercifully, at the end of the day, it was, and those of us who needed to get that far did. I want to begin with that illustration in order to introduce my subject tonight, which is this. How can a Christian know that he or she is saved for all eternity? See, salvation is a wonderful thing. There is nothing more wonderful, basically, than salvation. However, an assurance of salvation makes even the experience of salvation clearly that much more joyful and meaningful. And yet we can dare to say this, that even an assurance of salvation is not enough if it's not an assurance of eternal salvation. It's not enough to be sure that we are saved now if we can't be sure that we're going to be saved forever. And I'm not sure that I can put it any clearer than that. God wants us to know that we are eternally secure. And that glorious truth is written large on the pages of Scripture, that an assurance of the security of salvation is possible here and now to every child of God. Now, to develop that would take months and not minutes, as we're going to take tonight. But I want to concentrate on just one aspect, and that is this. What are the grounds, the basis, if you like, for the security of the Christian's salvation? Look with me at Colossians chapter 1 and verse 27. To them, Paul says, God has chosen to make known among the Gentiles the glorious riches of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Those seven words, Christ in you, the hope of glory, give give us the grounds for the security of our eternal salvation.
Say, well, let me just look at those words again.
I don't see either the word salvation or the word security in that. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Well, both the words are there. Look again. Both the words are there in disguise. Salvation is there, and the word that's used is the word glory. The word glory obviously has many uses in Scripture, and one of them, the one that pertains here, is that glory is the Christian's eternal home in the presence of his God and Savior. For example, in Hebrews 2, we read about God bringing many sons to glory. Paul speaks in Romans 8 about the glory that shall be revealed in us. 1 Peter 5 speaks of the God of all grace who has called you to his eternal glory. And when Paul here in Colossians 1 speaks of Christ in you, the hope of glory, it is that that he means. Christ in you, the hope of going to heaven when you die, to put it at its very simplest. The place which Joseph Hart in one of his hymns describes like this, where saints are free from every load of passion and of pains, God dwells in them, and they in God, and love forever reigns. So Christ in you, the hope of glory, means Christ in you, the hope of eternal, glorious, heavenly salvation. Well, if that's where the word salvation is, where is the word security? Christ in you, the hope of glory. The answer, strangely, is the word hope. And I say strangely because the word hope usually carries with it an air of doubt rather than of certainty. We say, I hope I'm going to get there in time. I hope the tests prove negative. I hope I can afford to buy this in time to give it to someone for Christmas and so on. And the very fact that we use the word hope indicates that there's a possibility that it might not work out. And I say again, the word hope has about it an air of insecurity in all of the illustrations that I've given. But in the Bible, exactly the opposite is true. In fact, the word hope is biblical shorthand for unconditional certainty. For example, look in Colossians 1, the chapter that we have opened before us, in verse 5. Paul speaks about the faith and hope and love that spring from the hope that is stored up for you in heaven. Now, without taking time to turn to it, you'll remember a verse in Hebrews 9, which says this, man is destined to die. You remember it, as I do, the King James Version, it is appointed unto man once to die. But in the NIV, man is destined to die, and after that to face judgment. Now the word destined, or it is appointed to man, in the King James Version, that word destined or appointed is exactly the same verb as the verb stored up here in Colossians 1 and verse 5. Now that shows us how certain it is. Man is destined to die. Paul says the Christian is destined to glory. Death is something that is stored up for everyone. Glory, that is heaven, is stored up for the Christian. Hope, in other words, is not an emotion, it is a foundation as far as the Christian is concerned. Glory is as certain as the grave. Man has an appointment with the grave. The Christian has an appointment with glory, and neither one So that's where the word, so that's where our security is. It's in this word hope. So it now reads, Christ in you, the unconditional and absolute certainty of eternal salvation in heaven. Now having said that, we've almost said all that needs to be said about explaining the meaning of the verse, but we're going to flesh and open it out in a number of ways, because it all leads us to our main question, where is the ground of this security? Well, the answer is in the other word in the text. Christ. Christ in you, the hope of glory. It is Christ. Christ in you, who is the absolute and unconditional assurance of eternal and glorious and heavenly salvation. Now that phrase, Christ in you, is the distinguishing mark of the Christian. Paul in Galatians 2 says, Christ lives in me. It's not just in apostles and full-time preachers. He writes to the Corinthians, and what a spotty lot of Christians they were. And he says, do you not realize that Christ Jesus is in you? Now, this is the ground, this is the basis of the Christian's eternal security. Not a principle, but a person. Not a creed, but Christ. Let me put it to you this way. The Christian's hope of glory is not the fact that Christ is in him, but that Christ who is in him as a fact. And it's on him, that is on Christ, that we must focus our attention. Remember in Luke chapter 4, when Jesus went to the synagogue, as his custom was on the Sabbath day, and someone handed him the scroll of the prophet Isaiah to read, and he stood up to read the scroll, and did, and then sat down, and we read these words, the eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fastened upon him. Now that's the moment we need in this service right now. That all of our eyes are focused upon him, upon Christ. Not on our failures, our fears, our feelings, but on him. Because he is the hope of our glory. He is the unconditional certainty of our eternal, heavenly, glorious salvation. And I want us to look, therefore, at Christ in a number of modes, in a number of ways, in a number of areas, if you will. First of all, the eternal Christ. He is the eternal Christ. Paul writes to Titus about the hope of eternal life which God, who does not lie, promised before the beginning of time. It's interesting how this subject has come up a number of times this week in the course of the ministry, and it is an amazing concept. Before the beginning of time means from eternity. And because this is something that was done from eternity, it is utterly unaffected by anything in time and space. And you find the same line of truth throughout the New Testament. Let me ask you four questions. How, if you were a Christian, were you saved? The answer is, by grace. But Paul writes to Timothy about this and says, this grace was given us in Christ Jesus before the beginning of time. Alright, on what basis are you saved? You say, well, on the basis of the death of Christ. I agree exactly. But in Revelation 13, we're told that the Lamb was slain from the creation of the world. Let me ask you another question. But who chose you to salvation? Well, your answer is, God did. And Paul says in Ephesians 1, he chose us